Good morning, good morning, good morning. It is another beautiful day. It's Wednesday. Time for our devotional, our release devotional 2.0. For those of you who don't know, because when we first started this whole pandemic journey, we were on a 21-day devotional out of my book, The Release Action Journal and Devotional. We went through each day, 21 days. It was a great time. This written for women, but the men jumped in and they were all about every topic that we covered. And so I said, hey, let's keep this party going. And so we did. And you all have been phenomenal in terms of support and just your feedback about getting fed mind, body, and spirit. Because though I focus on mindset as a certified mindset coach, my calling is to really make sure that people are equipped mind, body, and spirit as best that I can help in those areas. And so I see Dina D is in. Good morning, my beautiful one. And Michelle said, I am here for it. Good morning, good morning. Good to see you all. I also know that people are getting back to work. Things are opening up. Stuff is happening. And we're going to look at that too in terms of my streaming time, because I know a lot of you, you know, have said, oh my gosh, I love it, but now I'm back to work at 10 a.m. We're East Coast time. So I have to look at that and see if we need to move up an hour earlier or later. I don't know. You all tell me how that works for you all. Because I definitely want this to continue to be a resource that feeds you while we're in it. So for those of you who are new, this whole precept about release and the release devotional, what's that all about? It's based on this scripture for me, Psalm 46 and 10, one I leaned on while I was dealing with cancer. And the whole walk, that path, be still and know that I am God. The original Hebrew root of the phrase be still doesn't actually mean be still or be quiet. It means let go It translates as let go. So in other words, you read that again, it's release it, let it go, whatever it is, and know that I am God. And that's what we are here to do every Wednesday, is to help you release some stuff. You got to release some stuff. Hi, Miss Leola. Good to see you. Good morning. Good morning. Hello across Facebook, YouTube. What is happening? Thank you for your comments. Thank you for dropping replay comments and Periscope. I see you over here. So tap out those hearts that I love so much to kiss my cheeks. Our topic today is one that I think is going to hit everybody in some shape, form, or fashion. And I actually I'm going to give it a dual title, if you will allow me, because it hit me. You know how you read something, you meditate on something, and then you get in it in the morning, then you get some new revelation, and you're like, oh, what's that about? So I'm going to give it a dual title today. We're going to be talking about worth the wait, the waiting room. The waiting room. And if any of you are in a waiting position, a posture of waiting on something or someone to manifest or take shape or form, just go ahead and type in the comments. That's me. That's most of us. Most of us are waiting on something. Good morning, Savalas. Good to see you, brother. Good to see you. So if you're waiting on something, go ahead and type, that's me. I want to kind of just talk it out with you today. And then I'm going to call my brother in, Jamel Strong, who is, I call him JS223 because we're Jeanette Smith, Jamel Strong, JS. And then we both have February 23rd is our birthday. So I call him JS223. I'm going to call him in on the back end of this because God just laid him on my heart this morning. He's been in a time of consecration. That he may have a word or something to add to our discussion. And so I definitely want to call him in. What's going on, Anthony? Good to see you. Good to see you. So waiting, worth the wait, the waiting room. Let's just talk it out a little bit. At some point or another, you have sown seed, you've sown time, you've sown money, energy, prayers, and who knows what else, sacrifice that you've sacrificed to have something take place, to bring it to pass, to manifest it, a business model plan, a blog, a online business, some sort of entrepreneurial endeavor, a relationship, something, some aspect of your job. Everybody's been in that position where you've been trying to make something, give birth to something, right? And it you're in that place of waiting. You've sown it. You've sown the seed. You've sown the sacrifice. Now you're ready to see it. You want to see it come forth. You want to give birth to what you've been marinating and praying over for some of us for years, right? And things that that God has given you. And the thing that makes or breaks us is because we really don't understand all the moving parts. It's easy to have and be wrapped up in that dream. And I want you to think about what you've been waiting on for some time. But if you're like me, it can challenge you when you've been waiting and you've been sowing and you've been, you know, cultivating. It's seed time is what I call it for those of you who know me, because when a seed is planted underground, right, you've sown that seed, it's underground, it's in the dark, it's by itself. You can't really help the seed underground, right? It has to do its own thing. And there's a breaking that happens. And in that breaking, that's where we can get lost because, you know, we want to pull what's in the seed up out of the seed and have it manifested already. We want to pull out the end of the thing out of the seed and let's just make it happen. Let's get to it. But we don't have sometimes the constitution to wait for everything that needs to take place below ground in that seed to happen, which is the breaking open, which is the roots not only burrowing down into the soil for anchoring, but the networking, right? The roots that have to go out this way to network and to bring in nutrients and all of those things. And so just like a watching a birth I've never given birth. I've been there for two of my godchildren. One, my girlfriend had a C-section, and I was there for that. Miraculous, even though, you know, it wasn't a natural childbirth, so to speak, but miraculous nonetheless. And the other for, that was Torian. And then the other for Joya, which she didn't wait on me. We stepped out the room for half a second, and then she just came right on out. Hi, Monique. Good to see you. Hello, Jennifer. Welcome in the room. Hey, Dr. Anne-Marie. Good to see you. And so, you know, just like birth, you can't go in. You have to trust the master physician. And yes, we do have to bring babies, you know, to fruition earlier and all those types of things. But in that natural process, there's a place and space that you have to wait on for you even to be able to bring a child into the world earlier. You have to trust God. You have to trust the master physician, because our job is to receive that dream seed that the dream giver gives, and to work and cultivate and plant it and protect it and to do all those things. But we can never pull out what's in the seed. That's never going to be our job, right? And that's why I love the scripture that we have today. And I'm going to do it in a couple of different versions for those of you who love you some good King James. And then I'll read it in the Message version. For those of you that Christianity is not your faith, just receive these words of wisdom then as the divinely inspired wisdom that it is, coming out of a great book we call the Good Book. So the King James says it like this: "Hast thou not known? Has thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary?" There's no searching of his understanding. "He gives power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increases their strength. Even youth will faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." For those of you who are not into that good King James version, don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's the creator of all you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired out. He doesn't pause, catch his breath. Can you imagine? And he knows everything inside and out. He energizes those who get tired. He gives fresh strength to the dropouts. For even young people tire and drop out. Even young folks in their prime will stumble and fall, right? But those who wait on God get fresh strength. They spread their wings and soar like eagles. They run and don't get tired. They don't lag behind. I love that, because even the strongest among us can get tired. Even the strongest among us, the ones with the most faith, the ones who, you know, just we're gully with it. Even those, even us, we can get tired. And so even though you are here for it, God gave you a dream. He birthed that thing on the inside of you and you are here for it. But sometimes we just don't have the constitution to deal with everything that comes with the complications of bringing it to pass. And so we need God to renew our strength. Because the distance between what God promised and what God said is the waiting room. That's the space. And how many of us are in that place between what God promised and said and it coming to pass? If that's you, just say, "That's me." How many of you are waiting on something? And the thing about being in the waiting room, because trust, it's worth the wait. It is worth the wait. You can't always see it. You can't always feel it. But it is always worth the wait, especially if that's a God-given, God-inspired idea or dream that you are birthing. Not something you concocted in your own head, wouldn't it be a good idea? But you know that you know that you know that that's the thing that God showed you. Then it is definitely worth the wait. Savala says, "That's me." Jennifer says, "Me." Yes, yes, yes. I know many of you who God has given a great dream, whether it's a business idea or whether it is something that you're going to birth out of your intellectual property, things that God has been working with you on, and you've just been sitting and you've been waiting and you've been waiting and you've been working and you've been toiling. And while you've been in the waiting room, Candace says, definitely me. While you've been in the waiting room, you know, you're not the only one sitting up in the waiting room, right? You know, that's where our lower self comes to have a seat. And your lower self or the enemy will come and sit right up next to you. Right up next to you. You had those conversations. You're sitting in the waiting room. You're chilling. You're like, okay, I'm just going to let God do his thing. The enemy will come and sit right up next to you because the enemy is the father of lies. What's up, Trent? Good morning, brother. Good to see you. The enemy is the father of lies. Yeah, the distance between what God promised, what God said, and it coming to pass. That's the waiting room. The father of lies will come and have you doubt yourself, have you doubt your worth for even achieving your dream, will have you doubt what you heard. Did you really hear that from God? Is that what God said, or did you make that up? Will have you doubt the validity of the dream. That's crazy. Why would you even be trying to do that? And we'll even have you trying to doubt the dream giver, because that's what the enemy does. That's what our lower level self does, because our human condition in our flesh, we already deal with feeling unqualified, unprepared, unvalidated, unsure, flawed, and all those things. We already deal with that in our lower level self, just in our flesh and our humanity. That's our human condition. But we need our strength renewed, because that is not who we are. That's just a snapshot. Even if you mess some stuff up, even if you made some mistakes, doesn't disqualify you for your whole life's dream. You might have some work, catch-up work to do. You remember when you were in school and you missed your assignment and your teacher said, well, I'll give you some makeup work. You might have some makeup work to do. You might have tacked another year onto it. You might have to do some more things behind the scenes, but you have not disqualified yourself for everything that God even birthed you and put you here to do. That'd be crazy. Like, oh, well, you missed it. So your whole life, just kind of ride out your life, just kind of holding space. That don't even make no sense. Not for a God that's purposeful. Right? Then like, oh, you missed that hole. So nothing you can do. Yes, yes. Right? So that's why we need our strength renewed, because we have to be reminded that, okay, I messed up. Okay, I didn't make that one. Okay, I made the wrong call. Okay, you know, I didn't zig when I was supposed to zag, or I zigged when I was supposed to zag. It doesn't matter. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. Renew your strength. God doesn't get tired or have to stop and catch his breath. You didn't catch him off guard. He knows everything inside and out. So he energizes us, those of us who get tired. Because even though you've seen what God can do, you know what God can do, you've seen him perform it over and over and over again, you go, yeah, I know. God, yeah, he did this, he did that. You probably have a ton of testimonies where you've seen God move in your life, one miracle after another, another manifestation after another, that still does not make it easier to be in the wait. I also call that place the middle place. Doing the dirt work as a seed, just down there in the dirt. Because John Gray says it this way, between faith and arrival and the prayer and the placement and the worship and the breakthrough, that he calls the waiting room. Between your faith and the arrival, what you're believing for, between the prayer and the actual manifestation of the promise, and between the worship you do and the breakthrough, that is the waiting room. So what do you do while you're in the waiting room? What do you do? I had a ton of stuff I want to share with you today, but I think I'm going to break this up into two parts, because this is so good. I think we just really need to sit in this and get this part, that there's work for you to do in the waiting room. For those of you who are fathers who've had children, maybe you were there in the actual birthing room, or maybe you opted to be in the waiting room. There's still work to be done in the waiting room. I love the scripture out of Colossians 1:11, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy. Because patience and waiting gets a bad rap. Like, you got to wait and you got to look beat down, like somebody hit you with a ton of, you know, flour sacks. You got to be, you know, distraught, downtrodden. No, no, no. You can have endurance and have patience that comes with joy. There is always something to give God thanks for. There's always something to be grateful for. So even while you wait on that part of your dream, what can you give God thanks for? While you're waiting on your business to flourish, maybe you're working a 9-to-5 job. Well, look at that as your investor. And give that investor your all in all, work to your heart's desire. Give them the best of your best. And be grateful that you have that paycheck that will help you invest into whatever your thing is. That is something to be grateful for. For the relationship you have that needs some work, and maybe y'all might even need to go to counseling. Whatever it is, you have that relationship you know that God brought together. Be grateful for that. Be grateful for that you got something to work with. Some people are together, they don't even have anything to work with because God didn't bring it together. They just said, well, you showed up at the altar and I showed up at the altar, so I guess God brought it together. No, no, no. That was you and you and you. Not three yous. You and you, right? Whatever your circumstances, situation, I promise you, I know that you can look around and find something to be grateful for. Isaiah 64:4 says, from ages past, no one has heard, nor ear has perceived, nor eye has seen what God besides you, any God besides you who works for those who wait for him. There's always a wait. If it's worth having, it's worth the what? Wait, let's look at that in the message. If it's worth having, it's worth the wait. That they used to tell me all the time. I know y'all have heard it too. Anything good is going to cost you something. It's going to be worth the wait. Anything worth having, you're going to have to wait on it. That's true. Because there's so many intricate parts. We have no, let me tell you something. Your mind would be blown if you had to know exactly what happened. I don't think you all realize, just like some people want to show up and be in the birthing room to watch it, you don't really know what you're waiting on, especially men. You don't know what you're about to see. You don't have no idea. The closest a woman ever comes to death in the natural process is the birthing process. So you have no idea what you're about to see. But we say, God, we want to see all the pieces, all the details. I want to see all the moving parts. If you knew what it took to get your dream birth, heaven help you if you could sustain it. Because some people would not even, you would get to see the whole picture. Who had to be moved out the way so that you could move forward? Who had to be moved over to the side? Who had to leave this plane to be in the next plane? What had to do, what pains and losses had to take place? Not just your own, but what other things had to take place for you to get to where you needed to get? We could not sustain it. We couldn't sustain it. That's why he says, you don't need to be in the birthing room. Just wait in the waiting room. I got this. I'll take care of it. We have no clue how the small ripples, it's like the butterfly effect. You have no idea when you flap your wings on this side of the earth, what all takes place in that ripple to bring that dream to pass. Since time, before time began, no one has ever imagined, nor ear heard, nor eye seen a God like you who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who happily do what is right, who keep a good memory in the way you work. Right? Who keep happily and doing what's right. So while you're waiting, keep doing what you know to do that's right and do it right. The wait is worth the wait. Yeah, yeah, Elder. I like that. I like that. Jennifer says, I was just asking God, what specifically am I supposed to be doing while I'm waiting? Yes, yes. The waiting room is real. It is. It is. So let's talk about that. I love that question. What are we supposed to be doing in the waiting room? We're in anticipation. If we're going to stick with that metaphor of the waiting room versus the birthing room, in the waiting room, you're in anticipation. You're planning. You're speaking to that thing, right? I love it because we talked about who else is sitting with you in the waiting room. and how the enemy will show up and be speaking to you. Do you remember when Jesus was on the boat and the winds and the waves were crashing and they were all freaking out? The disciples were freaking out and they're like, ah, and Jesus rebuked the wind and he spoke to the waves. Some things you're going to have to rebuke and some things you're going to have to speak to. Some things you're going to have to rebuke and some things you're going to have to speak to. So when that lower level talk rises up in you, you're not worried. What you starts having you trying to second guess God, second guess your validity of your dream, your own worthiness with all that. You have to rebuke some of that stuff. And then there's some people you're going to have to speak to them. You might have to rebuke some people too, let's be honest. But you're going to have to speak to some people too. Like you can be in the waiting room with me if you're going to be praying me through. If you're going to celebrate with me. But if you're just in the waiting room to see if everything crumbles and falls, if your only reason for being in the waiting room is to see what tidbits you can carry back to the you know, the gossip club. If you're just in the waiting room with me because you just want to see how it's all going to work out and you're not really there for me, you can't be in the waiting room. In fact, you have to be authorized, don't you? You have to be authorized to be in the waiting room. You certainly have to be authorized to be in the birthing room. Some of us are not authorizing, are not qualifying people to be with us in this place of giving birth to what God has promised. And then you wonder why stuff is kind of janky because you're allowing other people's negative self-talk and their low latent level jealousies and other things, or just unbelief, to permeate and be a part of your processing. And listen, I got to help my own unbelief. I don't have room to try to deal with my unbelief that rises up from time to time and yours. So you might have to not be in the waiting room with me. You might have to wait in the car. You might have to wait in the car. JS22. Yes. 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 So don't entertain the enemy in the waiting room, y'all. And really start taking assessment of those who are around you. JS223, if you want to pop in, come in at any time. You're just going to have to keep them out from around you because honestly, you have to lead your life, not manage it. You have to lead your life, not manage it. And what do I mean by that? Because a lot of times we let the people around us lead us, or we manage them instead of giving leadership to them about how to qualify them to stay in the secret place of your life, to be a witness to what God is doing, right? Candace says, in my waiting room, I'm learning to be patient and obedient. That's it. You stay in anticipation. You make plans for what God's promised to come to pass. I don't see you in the waiting room, sir. Pop out and pop back in because for some reason I don't see you. Say that one again. I can't be dealing with both of our unbelief. When Jesus asks, you know, of our faith, you know, a wise man was truthful about it. He said, listen, I believe, but can you help my unbelief? My unbelief. You in, because sometimes you can be in that space of opposing truths where you believe and you have unbelief. There's some stuff that you're still having to struggle with. You believe God. You believe what's going to come to pass. You believe those things. But for whatever reason, that other side just still will fight you. Still fight you. The other thing that happens in the waiting room is that we get psyched out. So you're anticipating, you're planning and praying, you're speaking to it, you're protecting that seed, you're rebuking, right? Those that need to be rebuked, and you toss out what doesn't need to be tossed out. You speak to the other things that need to line up, even if that thing is you. If your mindset is out of alignment, you need to line that up. But the other part is the people that are sitting around you are people who too are in anticipation for their own thing. And sometimes it can get hard on us because we, hi Pat, how are you? Because sometimes we see their thing come to manifestation before yours. And then you kind of take a hit, like, oh man, right? And you start comparing and competing. You start looking around and you start thinking, oh my goodness, you know, what happened? Why is it taking so long for my thing to come to pass? Neil says, Romans 4:20, Abraham blessed God while waiting for the promise to come to pass. In the midst of waiting, he staggered, not at the promise through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving God glory. I'm waiting. I'm going to bless them. That's right. While we're waiting, we're going to bless them. And we no longer have to wait for JS223 to activate. Super Twin Power, activate. Hey, brother.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you today?
I am great. I love this subject today.
What?
It is the story of my life.
Yes. What? And that's why I wanted to bring you in. Really, God did really lay you on my heart this morning as I was doing this. And I was like, and I just texted him like, I don't know what you're doing, but you want to roll through? We both have been in those places where we have been in the waiting room, and we know because we came out that it is worth the wait. Yeah. What are those things and tools? Some that I'm sure we've talked about, but some that are unique to you and your personal walk that have helped you in the waiting room.
Well, you know, I was thinking as I was in the waiting room, literally today in the waiting room, waiting to come on.
Right.
I was thinking about how the scripture you read in Isaiah says that those who will wait on the Lord, that he will renew.
Yeah.
That God renews our strength. And Leah, just put it up there. I want to read that. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And that's the key that I wanted to bring out right there. And so when you wait on the plan and purpose of God, when you wait on God to fulfill what he has spoken for your life and not get ahead of his timing.
Yeah.
When we get ahead of his timing, it causes fatigue. It causes fatigue in our soul, and it causes fatigue in our spirit, man, because we're trying to make something happen that's not supposed to happen yet.
Yeah.
And so that causes you worry, because anything that God gives you to do, he graces you for it. He gives you grace to do the work. And so one of the biggest things that's helped me in the waiting room is I always am asking this question, and making sure, do I have grace for this assignment? Because if God has not placed this assignment in my hand, he's not responsible for giving me a grace to do it. And when I do things outside of his grace, it causes fatigue, it causes weariness. But when we wait on the Lord, our strength is renewed because we have not taken on tasks that we were not supposed to have.
My mind.
There's a rest in our soul that we are able to experience, because it's something powerful about when you wait in a space, you're able to reflect.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You're able to really take in the nutrients of that time period. And one thing I found for myself, you know, earlier on in my life, we're always busy trying to get to the next, you know.
Yeah.
Well, let me rush through this and get to the next. Let me get through this because I'm going to get to that. But we should not try to accelerate the ordained times that God has placed in our lives, because there is a nutrients that we're supposed to get that is going to prepare us and build us up for what is to come next. Another thing I thought about, Jeanette, was that our strength is renewed, but you know, we've been on this health journey, restoring our health, restoring our temples. But when you talk about even with your muscles and building strength is only built in resistance.
Yes.
And so God ordains seasons of our lives where we might go through rejection, where we might go through misunderstandings.
Right.
All these things will take place in the waiting room. But they're not designed to destroy you or to kill you. It's not designed to discourage you, but it's actually designed to strengthen you. Because what you got coming up next, you're going to have to be stronger. You're going to have a higher resistance level. You're going to have to be in a place where before, where somebody would say something to you, it would take you a week to recover. Now you need to recover in 60 seconds.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? And one thing I heard somebody say, the price turbulence at times is the price for flying high. So with every elevation, there's more, you know, things you're going to deal with. But if you're graced for it, you have gained all of the nutrients of everything that you've gone through along the way, every thing that you've experienced. And so what you can do is say, oh, no. I've never seen it like this, but I've seen this before, and I'm strong enough. Yeah, I'm strong enough to knock it out, you know, because I properly was strengthened in the waiting room.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I want to ask a question, and then I want to bring up an illustration for those of you who follow me. You know that I'll go back to this from time to time, because I just think as a visual person, it so strengthens me. But I want to ask this question. I want you all to observe yourselves and be thinking, and then type in the chat. How are you dealing with waiting? How are you at dealing with waiting? How are you at dealing with waiting? Now, while we wait on that, I just want to go back to something that Jamel was just talking about, the strengthening part. That's why I'm convinced that's why God doesn't show us everything about the dream, because who wouldn't want the end from the beginning? Who wouldn't? But and you've heard all the analogies used. If a butterfly comes out the cocoon too soon, it's still part caterpillar. It can't fly. If it doesn't do the beating of its wings against the inside of the cocoon to break free, it won't be strong enough to fly. All of those things are apropos and absolutely on time. Our pastor said, Jeanette and Jamel are preaching. Thank you, Reverend Doctor. We appreciate you. And love you. But this is my favorite visualization for the waiting room, because once you plant that seed, that thing is planted in you. God gives you that seed of purpose. There is the breaking that has to happen for that root to come out, and then you grow backwards, it seems, before you ever grow up, before the manifestation for everybody else to see what God is. And that's what we all want. We want people to say, I want you to know I'm not crazy. I want you to know that this, I'm following God, right? Yeah. But if Noah had rain show up while he was working on the ark, that would have been counterproductive, even though it might have given people what they needed to go, well, maybe he isn't crazy. Maybe something is about to happen. But that would have been counterproductive to what he was trying to do. So sometimes your work is going to look like it's going backwards before it actually starts moving forward. And that anchoring that you were talking about, that waiting on the Lord, is actually, it feels like in the waiting room that we're going further and further into the darkness, further and further into a position of moving backward versus moving forward. And then right when we think we start sensing that God is starting to move, something else takes off. But oh no, look, it's not going up. We're going out now. Now roots are going this way, because not only do we have to be anchored and grounded in our faith, we also have to be anchored and grounded in our connections. Nobody gets anywhere by themselves.
Right. That's right.
God uses people to bless and move and elevate us. Mm-hmm. Promotion might have been offered to you by a person, but God laid you on that person's heart.
That's right.
God made you the person for that time. And so now after that, then we start finally seeing some movement and growing up. And I always like this part right here, how the seed is still bent over. Mm-hmm. Well, because I liken it to you've been working out too. So let me just get visual real quick, because I know that this is going to bless somebody. We both dropping LBs over here. Let me tell you. But Yeah, that seed has been over, and I've told you all that sometimes when you're trying to push, you have to use the muscles of your greatest strength. And for most of us, that'll be our muscles in our leg. You have to bend over and push that thing back. You have to bend over and push that thing up, right? So don't be afraid in the middle of the process. Listen, people will come and try to sit you down. People will come and try to dress you down. People will come and try to make you feel small in your station and try, but don't even worry about it, because sometimes God will have you in places and spaces where you have to bend the knee, but you don't bend the knee and you're doing it in shame. You don't have to bend the knee and do it and give up your beliefs and your core beliefs and what you stand for. You might just, it's just bending a knee to stay silent, to stay and wait, and to watch and to be in position to watch. But when God calls you forward and ready, then you get up with all power and you get up with all strength. You build your head right on up. You bring your head right on up. And then after that time, that's when we start seeing the fruits of your labor. And notice that it didn't just go pop like an umbrella. It unfolds. The God's plan and purpose in our life unfolds and grows. So you never have to worry about, you know, is it gonna, what, and maybe I'm missing it. You're just in the waiting room.
Yeah. Jeanette, you know something else that's always been powerful for me, and I love that visual about where you started with the roots.
Yeah.
Is that I've always, God does his best work in the dark. He does work in the dark. It's the things that people don't know. It's the stuff that we don't know that he is doing. And it's the stuff that God has worked out that we don't even know. Some of the things that God has worked out on our behalf, we would not be able to handle it if we knew about it.
That's because what I'm saying.
our feelings, our little feelings, I think I got pretty thick skin, you know. But even with that, it's stuff still, everybody has a breaking point where you have to work through your little feelings and your little emotions. Where you're like, why are they talking about me? Or why are they doing that? There are things that God works out in the dark that we don't even understand. And the older people in the word of the Lord, the older saints, I call them the old saints, they would say, God, I thank you for protecting me from danger, seen and unseen. And that's what he does his greatest work in the dark. And the greatest work that God is doing in us is in the dark, because he's giving us roots that are deep and foundational. And when we are revealed, amen, that's just the fruit of years of work. That's why the waiting room is so important.
Tell me about it. Candace says, honestly, I did not have patience when waiting on God, but I had patience waiting on people. Now that I've been studying Kronos and Kairos and developing my relationship with God, it's easier for me because I'm understanding the purpose of waiting. You want to speak to that a little bit, Elder?
I do, because something just kind of jumped out of my spirit when I read that. And a lot of times the reason people have an issue with waiting on God, because they feel like God should be moving very swiftly on my behalf.
Right.
You know, it's right. Like, you're God, you're daddy, you're Abba.
Right.
Why aren't you moving, you know, quickly for me? And what we don't understand is, it's not that God is not moving for you. He's just not moving the way you want him to move for you. He's actually moving. His hand is already moved in your life. But what he's doing is, he is mandating a necessary time, a necessary waiting, a time of reproof, sometimes rebuke, of restoration, inspiration. Listen, the greatest inspiration comes in the waiting room.
Yeah, yeah.
The greatest inspiration. I do music, I write, and things of that nature.
You don't just do music, sir.
I'm just saying, there's many facets to us all. But I'm bringing that up to say this. Most artists, they write a large amount of music are in the waiting room. when they're not on stage. It's not when, because usually when you see them going forth or doing tours and things, they're not in a space of great clarity because they're performing what it is that they have prepared in the waiting room. So that's a lot of times when artists, they'll take a break, they'll take a time off, they might go sit in front of some water somewhere or go to some remote island, and so that they can sit and hear.
That's
be
right.
Restored, be renewed. So, but a lot of times we're asking God, we're a little impatient with God because we want him to move faster. We want him to move quickly.
Uh-huh.
And God is saying, you can't handle what I have for you next. That's why I've ordained this time for you in the waiting room, because I'm strengthening you. I'm preparing you. I'm stretching you. I'm teaching you to be patient. I'm teaching you to have long suffering. I'm teaching you to be meek.
You know,
all those things start to develop. Your love walk develops in the waiting room, and it manifests through meekness. It manifests through long suffering. It manifests through patience. It manifests through you having to sit here and trust me and not lose your mind. Because if you have to deal with some of these human beings who are not forgiving, see, God is forgiving. He is forgiving. He doesn't hold stuff over our head. But human beings will hold, they have a retention level that is crazy. So all of these things are so important in the waiting room. God does his best work in our lives in the dark. It's the unseen times that are the most powerful.
And I want to speak to just even something about guilt and shame in the waiting room. Mm-hmm. But I want to, Ross says, this is good. Tamara says, yes, Elder Strong. Monique says, thank you for the insight on artists taking a break and why. And I know, Monique, that you're in that time right now. And let me just say, he doesn't just do music, y'all. He is music.
Oh, my goodness.
One of my, they need to know that he is a gospel artist in his own right and standing, y'all. I mean, he just something. So, oh, look, I'm on your website.
Oh, yeah, you sure are from one of the Discovering Your Voices, yep.
Oh, yeah. There's a mentoring program that he did in Alabama that he is still doing and that I got a chance to take part in. But I love that about him because he's always trying to help people find their voice, discover their voice, and use their unique voice. And we mean that not just about your singing voice, but about your voice as a unique individual. And so I love that about him. He has one of my favorite worship songs he wrote,
wow.
My Hands Are Lifted Up. And he knows that. I've told you that. But that just speaks to the level, y'all, of when he says he understands what artists go through. And I think that can apply to most creatives, no matter what you're birthing or creating. There is a time and a place where you do have to squirrel away and get refilled. Yes, Elder, his music is everything. Is everything. I want to give us a couple of tips about dealing with waiting, but I also want to encourage people who you made a mention of. You know, we talked about the stuff that can happen in the waiting room. The enemy shows up, and our lower level self, sometimes it's not even the enemy. All he has to do is drop a plan. Are you sure? And then walk away. And then because we're already battling with the uncertainty and feeling worthy enough and good enough and smart enough, or I have enough resources, and all of those things always, you know, try to rise themselves above our faith level of believing God. I'll take this first. Ross says, yes, yes, Elder Strong, you're also a blessing to the youth. Thank you for how you pour.
Oh, wow. Praise God.
As a former educator, he is the youth minister at our church. And so we love and appreciate him for all his efforts. But I don't want people to don't go into a place of shame. And let me tell you what I mean. It is okay if you're persecuted to feel some sort of way about being persecuted, because then you just wouldn't be a human being. Like, you would be a robot, right? You could be angry and sin not. So it's not about feeling bad about that. It's about, one, not trying to now live your life to gain the adoration or validation of man, woman, whatever, people, right? you have to continue to still do what God has called you to do.
Yes.
Because I think that so often we judge success or we judge forward motion by having everybody's cosign, everybody's signature. Everybody's signature is not going to be on your stuff. And God does that for a purposeful reason.
Yes, he does. So
you get the reward. Everybody's signature ain't on your paper.
That's right.
Like, we're mine.
That's right.
Right? Because mm-hmm. they will know that God did this through you, not them.
Right.
There have been things, I don't know if you've had this experience, Jabel. I have been in situations where magnificent people of great authority and influence have shown up in my life and been like, yes, I'm going to get behind you on this, that, or this project, or this, or that, or that. And then it just mystically, magically, just kind of fades out, just goes away. Like, what happened? And I had to understand. So in the middle of it, you go, did I do something? Does it, you know, did I do something? Da, da, da. And then you just realize God's timing also includes God's purging.
That's right.
Sometimes they may look good on paper. It may seem right in, you know, logistics. But at the end of the day, God knows what's in the dark, right? God knows what's developing in the dark. And God knows that's not going, So you cannot, she's singing, my hands are lifted up. Yes, that's my song. That is my song. That's right. Everybody doesn't have to, you don't want them to co-sign on your stuff.
No. Can I say this too about that?
Yeah.
Resilience is one, when you talk about some of the main ingredients for greatness.
Mm-hmm.
Resilience is one of those main ingredients.
Absolutely.
Most, and I'll talk about as far as artists that artistry. Most of the most celebrated artists I know have full projects that have never come out.
Yeah.
Along the journey, like they have full projects, including the one you're talking to right now. But I'm talking about they have done completed works.
Yeah.
Completed body of works.
Yeah.
And if you are going to be successful, if you're going to be great at whatever God has placed in your hands, you're going to, I really teach people this, how to properly deal with rejection.
Yes.
Rejection is a part of the process. And it is something that you will experience in the waiting room.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because even as we were talking about that seed, the seed that's planted is in the dark by itself.
Yes.
And here's the thing. We focus a lot about having the resilience to stand in that space of what seems like the middle place, right?
Yes.
And not moving and all that.
Keep talking. Keep talking.
You're fine. But the other thing that works well for that is that you are protected in that space. There's nothing around. In the dark, you are covered. Yeah, nobody knows about your great plan. Yeah, nobody might know about what God is doing in your life. And yeah, you know, maybe you haven't seen the effects of, you know, things coming to fruition or even signs of life sometimes, but you're also protected in that space. And that's really important because God knows that there are people that will come and pluck that seed up, that they will try to come and destroy that seed. They will try to destroy that seed of purpose that's on the inside of you. So don't just look at the dirt work as alienation, solitary confinement, and all that. It is also for your protection. Bastard's running. I see
it's
you.
It's the manure, though. Let me tell you, as I continue to look at that dirt, let me tell you something. It's the times of disappointment.
Yeah.
It's the times of rejection. It's the times, as you were talking about, that people made you these promises and then they finagled on them. You know, like you said, they mystically went away.
Yeah.
It's the manure of life that gives you the nutrients that you need to be strong and to make it. I'm telling you, Jamel today has such a firm foundation because of the things I went through. You know, I'll share this with you. We were talking about the waiting room because I'm presently in a waiting room experience right now. But my strength is being renewed. I'm having fresh vision, clarity. I do believe that 2020 is the year of clarity. Clarity.
Even if you don't like what you see sometimes, you got a clear vision. Clear vision.
It's a divine pause. When would we have ever thought that the whole world would have said, listen, I knew it was real when the NBA said we're not playing.
I know, that's right. I think that was everybody. I think that was a marker for a lot of people. They're like, oh no, this is for real. Like, this is serious.
I said, all these pastors were like, oh, wait a minute, the NBA? I guess we can't.
Right. Yeah. We can't go through it. Right, right.
But it's in when we embrace it, you know. I was, even since I've moved, you know, some of those who don't know me, whatever, I've been in Baltimore now almost close to 2 years, going on towards 2 years almost. But I was in and out, you know, I was traveling, you know, I was here, but I was out. I was here, I was out. And so I went from being in and out to being nowhere but at your house.
Right.
And about to put out a project, a full body of work that I have kind of poured my whole heart and God had given me into. But when I tell you, I'm so thankful for this time.
Yeah.
I'm so thankful. When we embrace it, and a lot of people are fighting it doing busy work. The worst thing you can do in the waiting room is take on assignments that God did not give you.
Because you're wasting your energy for what
you're
supposed
it.
To be doing.
You're
Absolutely.
Wasting it. You're wasting it. You're wasting it. And your best self cannot come forth when you're busy taking on little side jobs to make your soul feel at peace about right. being uneasy.
That, I know you and I both have talked about busyness. That is not a spiritual gift. And how being busy will make you sometimes feel like, oh, I am doing something. I am right. getting, like, it just feeds your flesh, but it does not have anything to do with your overall move toward your big goal. And let me tell you, there's a story I wanted to share. Some of you, a few of you have heard this story, but it's also a testament to how if you don't abide by God's timing and you try to force something, how it could be so to your detriment. Back when I was still doing entertainment, I had gotten, my agent had gotten me an opportunity to audition for a talk show. Like for real talk show, network talk show in Hollywood. Howie Mandel, who is on, what is it, America's Got Talent now, was doing a talk show and they were looking for a sidekick, like his female Ed McMahon. And I, at the time, I'm trying to remember how young I was. It was early 30s for me, but I was still young, if you know what I mean.
Did they want you to be Robin? Did they want you to be his Robin? You remember?
This show didn't manifest, so let me tell you. So I flew out to California. I drove out to the Hollywood sets, and I'm driving, you know, onto these big movie sets and where they, you know, do NBC studios and these big movie and things I only see on TV. And I'm just like, oh my God. The problem was on the plane, on the flight out there, I started getting deathly ill. Like, I don't even know what was wrong with me. Like, not to throw gross y'all up, but like, I got sick on the plane, like walking off the plane, I got sick. I was like, something's not right. I had fever. I had all this stuff going on. I'm excited on the one hand, but I'm deathly ill. I'm in the bed. I'm trying to figure it out. So much so, I was so sick. I got to the audition late. I walk in. I meet Howie Mandel. We're on the set. We're talking. My audition, bonk. Horrible. Oops, sorry. I was letting you adjust. Horrible. You good? And
yeah, I think so.
After that, I just decided, do the best you can, and we'll see what happened. But I knew in my heart of hearts, it was horrible. I was late and then my mojo wasn't working. I wasn't in it. And so I got back home and went to the doctor and found out that I had not a like a kidney something infection. Something minor. They treated antibody. It was fine. But it was like a big, huge deal. It started the day I flew out there. Now, listen, they hired somebody. She moved her life from New York out to LA. They didn't even get out of pilot season. They didn't even get out of pilot season. I would have left my good job. I would have gone through all this, moved my life. And so sometimes, and I'm not saying the guy's got to give you a kidney infection. I'm not saying that.
Right.
That sometimes you just never know. Because that woman, because I followed it, so I watched her. There was a lot of fallout for that poor lady because of that. Because her husband didn't want to move. Her family, there was a whole thing that happened with that. And I thought, my God, that's why you got to allow God to do whatever God is doing and trust his timing on everything. Because what we don't know could hurt you. What you don't know could actually hurt you. Let's look at these three tips. First of all, what you've been hearing us say is we got to gain confidence that God has a good plan for us. And we embrace our faith and our personal examples of his faithfulness. Every single one of us can go back and look and say how God has brought us through this, how God has manifested that, how God has redirected when we were going the wrong way. We know that God is faithful to do it. We have to gain confidence in that fact. And then we also have to focus on God instead of the weight. A lot of times what makes it worse is that we're focused on the dirt around us when we're in that space, instead of focusing on how to learn more about what we're trying to do, how to look for, how to participate and partner with God. Right?
Yeah.
There's work to be done in the waiting room.
Serve. You're serving. You are serving. And that's what, that is the biggest part. When I was talking about getting the nutrients of everything that you're supposed to in the waiting room with excellence, you want to do everything with excellence that has been placed in your hands instead of just trying to get to what's next. Oh, when I get to what's next, then I'll be excellent. No. You must be excellent right where you are. One of the biggest things that I always took for myself was, and really I heard the Lord say this to me, he said, bloom where you've been planted. Yep. Bloom. Where I dropped you in the earth.
Yes.
Where I dropped you in the earth.
Yes.
Right there. Let your roots go deep.
Yeah.
And you take all of the experiences, all the different things, all of the manure, sometimes you got to push through, but it's going to be a blessing for you. And when you have to push up through the earth and you come forth and then the fruit come, bloom where I've planted you, and then I'll take you where you need to go. I'll take you where you need to go.
Absolutely. Because back to that story I was telling you, what I realized was I was not ready for that level of success. And I often think that it could have broken me because I was too tender at that point in my life. I didn't have I don't know what y'all think, but I feel like everybody need a little grit on them. You gotta have a little bit of grit on you.
If you're gonna be out here in these streets, you better have some grit. That's all we're gonna say
about that. But you gotta have a little grit. And I didn't have all that. I had a little naivete. I had a little bit of everybody's good. And think about it, Hollywood. Really? Do I really think that everybody would have had my best interest in mind? Do I really? So I just know that I was not ready for that space. I was not ready for that. And so that's why what Jamel just said about working where you are, blooming where you are. I have a mantra that's similar to that, which is, you know, leave everything better than you found it. I believe everything where you found it. This is laughing out here in these streets, especially Baltimore streets. Absolutely.
These church streets. Oop.
Did you say it? Yes, you did. Because where there are people, there is stuff. There's manure.
Manure. All right. I said it. Go ahead. Go for it.
He is manure.
I'm just saying because I walk, you know, I'm on the street every morning going to work out and I pass a lot of manure. That's all I'm saying.
Hunty, out in these streets. So there you go. So the working and building of not only your character, but your ability to deal with hard to deal with people. Your ability, now he's really gone, manure in the church. Yes, sir. As if we have to tell you. Renee's having a crying. But listen, that's the thing. You see it now as I can't believe I'm dealing with this, but it's also a time. The waiting room is also a time for your self-assessment.
That's right.
For you to take a look at yourself and see, how do I handle people that do this? Or can I take constructive criticism? Or am I able to do this? Am I able to handle that? If somebody is targeting me, how do I handle that? Because that will be with you always. That will be with you. There's always going to be somebody who thinks you need to be doing it different, like them.
How
are you going to handle it? Pastor, y'all better be real.
Listen, it's so important, though, because if you're going to be an effective leader, you are going to have to be mature with dealing with diverse personalities.
Absolutely.
Some people are low down and they intend on being low down. And then there's others who do low downness that really don't mean to be low down.
Well, we talk about it here all the time that people have been through trauma, drama, driving their behavior. And I know, I get it. It's like the time I was working in a camp for mentally handicapped children, and they kept saying, don't work with this one because he can be violent. And I was like, but then he's all alone all the time. And so I started spending time. It got better. And he would even hug me sometimes. And then one day he just clocked me in my face.
I need you to know it.
Jaw. And what, I can't be mad because that's part of his, what's going on within him. Right. So I had to learn how to adjust myself. Now I didn't stop loving him, but I became more aware.
You loved him in a different manner.
At distance. So we have to learn how to deal with me. Let me tell y'all, y'all are being funny, but some people you have to love from a distance.
Well, and some of that is too, because when people are recovering at different stages from trauma, there are certain things that can be triggers. So so for me, I'll just use myself. Even as a minister, as a leader, when I go to engage people, I try to go in with the mindset of not being reactive. I don't go in being reactive. I try to go. So that's why I try to be intentional about getting rest. I try when I have to go and minister, because I know if I'm not properly rested, then I'll be more susceptible to reacting. Right. Yeah. So all of those things are important when you talk about showing up, when you talk about going and engaging people. So I try to be in a posture where I won't be reactive, because different things trigger different people. And so that I won't mishandle my position or mishandle them.
Yes.
Those are things you learn in the waiting room.
Absolutely. That's why I like space and grace, because it gives you a better vantage point. Because sometimes you have to see that thing, at least for me. Now, there's some discernment and things that kick in, but at least for me, what I've learned about me is, and maybe for some of you who are change agents, the way you're built is to come and effect change and to come and help better things. And that's the thing that turns on in you whenever you meet a circumstance or situation. For me, I've had to learn to push pause and step back, because that's where I get my better perspective on the situation instead of being right up on it. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Pause gives me the space to look at it from a couple of different angles, and also to know, and you kind of mentioned this, what I'm supposed to be change agenting and what I'm not. Some things I'm not supposed to be change agenting, and I have learned very well now in this season how to just let things go. Reverend Ada said, y'all, whew, say it again for the folks in the back row. My grandma said it like this: love folks using a long handle spoon. Amen, amen, amen. And that does not, let me say, that can sound like, oh, you're putting people up, but no, because no. Here's the other thing, and this gets into a whole nother topic, but for some people who are dealing with trauma and going through trauma, if you're not careful, what they've been through requires their surroundings and the people in it to be a certain way, or else it will be trauma. It will be triggered. And if you don't know how to navigate that space, you can unknowingly, on both ends, what they're doing and what you become part of is manipulated into a certain thing. Whether either you become an enabler to some behavior that really just needs to be dealt with through counseling and through prayer and through some other stuff, or you become not you to acquiesce, to try to be with this. And so you have to, that's all, like I said, that's a whole nother thing. But I just want you all to know that pushing pause and stepping back, you might say, well, God, am I equipped to be dealing with this person? And God may say, that's not your burden to bear. That's not that's not your cross to carry. And you have to honor that too. Candace said, I had to figure this lesson out this weekend. Jesus, you got to love people from afar. And even the pastor's running. All right. Tip number three. Transform a difficult season into a life-changing one by identifying the opportunities to develop new closeness with God. A lot of times we're in the middle of it, in the waiting room, in that dark room, in the dirt, doing the dirt work, we only think about the weight. We only think about the challenges that come with that. We don't look for the opportunities. You all remember me saying, and even having guests on at the beginning of this pandemic, where I said, yes, there is hell to deal with right now in the earth, but there are also opportunities, and we have to learn to train ourselves to see opportunities in the midst of disruption. You have to learn. That's how people thrive. That's how people get ahead, because while other people are caving into the weight of what is, other people are going, I see it, but what else is there? I see it, but what other doors may be opening? I see that, but how can I use this, and what is God doing in me to help, you know, propel things forward? Or in your, as you said, like, how do we serve through this? How do we make something out of this? And so always know that there are opportunities in the waiting room, but you have to be willing to see that, which means you've got to change your focus, your focus, because what you think on the longest becomes what you believe the hardest.
That's right.
What you think on the longest becomes what you believe the hardest, whether it's true or not. Where focus goes, that's where energy flows. Timothy says,
I can speak to this for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, I can speak to this one. Transform a difficult season into a life-changing one. So, you know, as I just spoke about, we're in the pandemic. And at the beginning of it, because, you know, we just really didn't know. You know, we were like, okay, we're going to be here for a month. So it's pray, let's eat, drink, and be merry. I mean, you know, in your
Yeah, we got you. We didn't mean to turn, but yeah, we got you.
Yeah, you know, we just didn't know. So it's like, okay. And so in the mid, like at the top of it, I had to pause and say, wait a minute. Because there was so much uncertainty. And, you know, I was praying, but I needed purpose in this pandemic. What am I supposed to be doing? I had to put a pause on it, right? Yeah. In this difficult season, to make sure that it would be a life-changing one for me, you know, by season into a life-changing one by identifying opportunities to develop closest to God and allow, as I get close to God, to develop me.
Yes.
Even in the practicality of who he created me to be.
Yes.
So yeah. I had to make some adjustments.
Yeah.
So one of the things in those adjustments, so I started a consecration and it was 21 days when I started. I felt like I heard God say, do 21 days. Yeah. And with that, in that, so I wanted to develop my spirit, my soul, and my body. I wanted my total man to come out of this pandemic, that when I come out, I'll be better than when I went in, because I know that this is a divine pause, and I am not supposed to be the same Jamel that I was in March when I come up out of here. We are to be different. We are to, I just believe that with everything in me. I'm not even supposed to go back. When we come out of this, I'm not supposed to re-engage how I operated in church. I'm not supposed to re-engage how I operated in business. I'm not supposed to re-engage how I operated in relationships. Everything about me, I believe it should have grown if I have taken the proper nutrients of this time, right? Yeah. And so I engaged in this consecration.
Uh-oh.
Can you hear me?
You popped out, but now you're
back.
Yep.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know what that, I think somebody probably tried to call. So I did a consecration, and also I engaged on a physical temple revival, like, you know, in regards to exercising, my diet, the things that I do in regards to that. And then also with learning new skills. So all areas in my life. So spiritually, really engaging God and not wasting his time and not just doing Netflix sun up, sundown every day, you know, that kind of thing. But really engaging and saying, God, what do you have for me? And so at the end of the 21 days, I heard him say 40. I said, all right, Holy Spirit. So today, actually, which is, you don't know what it's called, all of it swooped in there together. Today is the 40th day.
Oh, it's the end of your consecration.
Yeah, but it's not over, because he had been dealing with me and he told me 90 days.
Come on now.
And so, because what I know is I'm in the waiting room. I am in the waiting room, and I have literally the baby's head is coming out. Okay.
I just need you to say that again. You are what?
I am in the waiting room. Can you?
Because the wake up. I heard you. I just had to do the wake up call, because you hit on my last point. The pandemic has been our waiting room. Pandemic has been our waiting room, and everything that he just talked about should be, if you haven't been doing those things, those are things that you should be considering. Like, you shouldn't come out of this the same as when you went in. Listen, with all the content, even if I know there's more people on the internet than just me, Elder Jamel does devotionals on his page too. People are doing things everywhere. If you're in the same spiritual space you were when you came in, if you're in the same mindset space when you came in, if you're in the same physical space as when you came in, because the waiting room, that's where you get stuff handled. I didn't know today was day 40. You're right. I didn't know.
Yeah. So when I got your text, because I had just finished a devotional, and I was like, oh yeah, because I didn't see it. I said, absolutely. But I'm just saying this to encourage someone. First of all, this is not to make you feel like, oh, Lord, I ain't been doing that.
I missed it, right? You
know? No. Because I was at that space. I mean, because I really re-engaged on probably, I would say, June. June is when I kind of, actually, I had to attend a funeral of a friend of mine who passed in June. It really was after that. It really, for me, was after that. It was like, what are you going to do with your breath?
I think different things like that are the wake-up calls. And I'm glad that you said that, because maybe for some people, not trying to be funny, but I rang the little bell because I called that the wake-up call. But maybe for some of you, that's what that is. Maybe this is your wake-up call. Maybe that what you've heard Jamel or I share today is the wake-up call. There's no guilt. There's no shame. It's just a reminder that, you know what? Because listen, yes, things are opening up slowly, but we're not back to 100% where we're going to be or where we used to be. And I pray to God, we don't go back to 100% of what we used to be, what we used to be.
That's
but hear me, you can change at any time. So let this be encouragement to you.
Yes.
Yeah, I got it. Yeah. Let this be encouragement to you that it, whatever you've been thinking about, whatever, you know, that God's been laying some things, God's been laying new things in your heart in this period of time. Right.
Absolutely.
I'm sure for you going through consecration, that's been true too. That God's been laying new things on your heart, new understanding, new ways of being.
Writing songs, writing.
Yes.
I mean, you know, all that type of thing. You know, I mean, all of those type of things. When you sit, like, it's, we have to be still and stand still. We have to be still and stand still. We have to silence our soul, the rumblings that's going on. And just be still, and then stand still so that you can see with clarity that which God is showing you. And this is what I love about God. He only reveals to us the things that we need to know now. He only reveals to us the things that we need to know now. And if we have a firm foundation, if we're rooted, and I'll say this and I'll be done. I think about Abraham so much. About how he had to go on a journey, you know, and how Isaac, he gave birth, you know, he had Isaac, but then God told him to take Isaac up to the mountain to sacrifice him. This is what I love about what Abraham said. He said, when it was time for him to ascend up, he told his servants, the lad and I will return. He didn't know how, but he knew God had made him a promise. And what do you do when you know the promise that God made you is not, doesn't make sense for his present instructions for your life? You have to trust him based on his word. So he went up whole time knowing that in a little bit, you're gonna have to kill him. He's being challenged with having to kill his son. And even in the act of it, how God stayed his hand and he said, look over in the thicket. The provision was there. But the biggest thing is, it was at that point that he received the fulfillment. That was that last act, that last major test. God never gives us a test where he has not given us the information to pass it.
Yeah.
And if we would trust God, and this is the hope that I've had. I want to just share that with your listeners. This is the hope that Jamel Strong has had through different seasons, through failed contracts, through contracts that I walked out of because they were failing. I mean, just different things that I've experienced in my life, having to move, you know, and just different things at different times, leaving jobs, leaving successful careers because of the purpose, and then having to be in the waiting room. I want you to know that if you have a word from God, when all you have is a word from God, a word from God is all you need. That's all you need. And your strength is renewed. Your strength is renewed when you wait on God. Don't make it happen. Wait on God. God always sends resources when it's time to go forward. Yeah. Always. I had a great friend of mine. I was asking them, when are you going to do the next project? When are you doing the next project? And they said to me, every time it's time for me to do a next project, God always sends the resources. God graces us for whatever it is we're supposed to do. So you haven't missed your time. You haven't missed your season. God is just preparing you. He loves you. He that has begun a good work in you, he is faithful. He is going to complete it until the day of his return. God is not a liar. I tell people all the time, Jeanette, I'm not fighting against the devil. He's already defeated. He's a defeated foe. Our fight is, the Bible says, fight the good fight of faith. So our fight is against the enemies of our faith.
Yes.
Things such as time become the enemies of our faith. Location for some of us. I mean, you know, just different things, doubt, fear, past trauma. Those things come against us to try to lure us out of position.
Yeah.
Because lies are only effective when you're out of position. But when you stay in position, when you trust God, when you trust him at his word, and despite the time when it might seem longer than you thought it was going to be, but you know he's going to do it, you can prosper in a pandemic. Yeah. In this waiting room, your yeah. best self can be revealed.
Yes, 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 yes. And you have to be in partnership. And I hope that's what you all got today, is we're encouraging you to be in partnership with God.
Yes.
Because the waiting room is just like our grounding scripture for this entire series. Be still doesn't really translate be still. It means let it go.
Let it go. Let
go is an action. You have to let go of some stuff and know that God is God. So whatever mm-hmm. you've been holding on that no longer serves you, whether it's a way of thinking, a way of believing,
yep.
behaving, or even some things that you mm-hmm. held on to because that was what you wanted, not necessarily what God said, but
That's
it was
right.
how you wanted it. Let it go. And don't, the other part of what he said, don't be discouraged in the 11th hour. Some stuff shows up in the 11th hour.
Ooh,
right,
I'm telling you.
Right before the ending chime strikes. Right before stuff will show up. Pamela Gill says, good morning to you and the tribe. Elder Strong, thanks for your wisdom. Bless you all. Trust and wait. Hallelujah. This has been a great weekend. I'm glad. Well, brother, I know you and our lunch break, so we're going to get into it. I wanted to say, I saw somebody else that said that this was something that had really blessed them. I couldn't find her. Oh, Miss Pat said it's holy confirmation from you. There you are, Miss Pat. I was looking for that holy confirmation. So glad. And so for everybody who is having a hard time in the waiting room, I just want to ask Elder to pray now. This has been a great Wednesday. I'm glad. I just knew that this has been something we all deal with in different levels.
Yeah.
And in different places and spaces of time. But it is worth the wait. Wait on it. It's worth the wait. As you partner with God, believing him, doesn't mean you will have times where you sway. But if you will anchor down, get those roots anchored down and believe and trust that everything else, the way it works for your good is because of the way you work it. If you see it as resistance, as you see it as weights to build your muscle, as you see it as weights to build your character, as you see it as ways to build your stamina in dealing with people and dealing with stressful situations and dealing with whatever it is, you can't get to your next if you are already operating in a next. I think we forget that. So trying to pull it down on you now when you're not ready, you're asking, that's like a death sentence. Don't do that.
Yes, it is.
Wait on God.
Right.
God will show up. Will you pray for us, Elder?
Sure, my honor. I reckon that the word of the Lord says, I reckon that the sufferings of this present time cannot be compared to the glory. There's a weight of glory that's about to hit your life. And that's why the waiting room is important. And God, I thank you for every person that is tuned in today. I thank you for encouraging and uplifting their hearts, inspiring them, letting them know, God, that this is a necessary season, God. Lord, letting them know, God, that you are with them. They are not alone, God. You know what they feel. You feel what they feel. You understand what they're going through. And God, I thank you even now for just touching their hearts in a way to let them know that you're right there with them, that you have great things in store, for you have the plans that you have for them is so far greater than they can even fathom in their mind. And Lord, I thank you for just even now through this platform and Jeanette and her heart to just want to enrich people. I thank you, God, that we have been inspired. We've been uplifted. We thank you for direction. We thank you for clarity. We thank you for renewing our strength, being renewed as we obey your word, that our strength is renewed, that the joy and just hearing the testimonies of others, we are able to overcome. And we thank you, Lord, that this platform will continue to flourish, that lives will continue to be changed and uplifted and inspired. And we thank you for this. Amen and amen, amen, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen and amen. And I see y'all are starting to sing. That's what I was thinking too. I was thinking about go out with a little friend. They that way on the Lord. Yeah. Thank you so much, Elder.
My honor.
All right, y'all have a great weekend. We'll see you next time. What's a weekend? Ooh. It ain't no weekend yet. Sorry. See y'all on Friday. We'll be back on Friday, y'all. Love y'all to life. Take good care. Bye-bye.
Feel what you gotta do, just believe. Feel what you know. Feel everything you must remember. My God is able, and He has brought you. Come on, it's up. Let's say it like this.
Wait on the Lord, and He will come through. Wait on the Lord.
Wait on the Lord.
Wait.